So good morning, everybody. Good morning, 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 and welcome to a rather sparse congregation this morning, but the quality is here, I can see. Apologies at the start from Graham. Graham was supposed to be leading the service this morning. He's injured his foot and not able to come, so you have to put up with me. I was going to play the organ, and Graham take the service. So what we're going to do is Miss Ash is going to help with some of the music, and I'll play the organ for a couple of the hymns, because it's easier to sing when there's only a few of you and you've got a loud organ. But that means you might have to be patient with me as I go backwards and forwards. We have a church meeting on Wednesday at 7 o'clock. That's our church meeting where we look at our priorities for the coming year. And next Sunday is Remembrance Sunday. There are leaflets here at the back about the events next weekend. Karen is taking the service. There will be an installation in the chapel on Remembrance Sunday, which is open. You can see it's called The Turning of the Leaves, and there is an information sheet about all of those events that are taking place then. And in the evening, in the bar, there will be the showing of a film. Is called The Work, and there'll be a discussion following it afterwards. But all the information is on these little sheets. I see we're filling out. Joe, you're not doing your job properly. And if you're here for the first time and would like to leave this little card, you can fill it out and put it in the collection plate, these welcome cards, so that we can keep in touch with you. This Sunday is the start of November. It's November the 5th, but that's got nothing to do with anything. It's the start of what we call the Kingdom Season, which is the last period of the Church's year when we have special Sundays. This Sunday I've chosen the readings for All Saints, when we think about saints who passed and those who passed on. Next Sunday is Remembrance Sunday, and then as we lead forward to Advent, we think more about the Kingdom of God and its importance and its meaning. So I would invite you at the start of our service to pray. Let us pray. We give thanks, O God, for all the saints who ever worshipped you, whether in brush arbours or cathedrals, weathered wooden churches or crumbling cement meeting houses, where your name was lifted and adored. We give you thanks, O God, for hands lifted in praise, manicured hands and hands stained with grease or soil, strong hands and those gnarled with age, holy hands, used as wave offerings across the land. We thank you, God, for hard-working saints, whether hard-hatted or steel-booted, head-ragged or aproned, blue-collared or three-piece suit-suited. They left their mark on the earth for you, for us, for our children to come. Thank you, God, for the tremendous sacrifices made by those who have gone before. Bless the memories of your saints, God. May we learn how to walk wisely from their example of faith, dedication, worship, and love. Amen. We're going to sing, Seeking First the Kingdom of God and His Righteousness. Thank you.
reading is taken from Revelations chapter 7, verses 9 to 17. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshipped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within the temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes."
Sasha will sing the verses and you can sing the chorus each time. You can stay seated for this.
Thank you. Our second reading comes from Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 12. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecute the prophets who were before you." May God grant us understanding of his word.
I chose the readings today for those set for All Saints Day, which was last Wednesday. But it begins the series of services during November, which brings the church's year to a close. In recent years, the church has called this the Kingdom Season. All Saints, All Souls, and then Remembrance Sunday, and then concluding the Feast of the Reign of Christ. We think of those who have passed on, we think of martyrs, those who have sacrificed their lives for others, we think of those we have known and loved and cared for. And we think of the church and its role in God's purpose of bringing a better future into being. One of our readings came from the last and possibly the most difficult book to read in the Bible, the book of Revelation. It's a prophetic vision written early in the story of the Christian church, when communities were very small and this new religious practice was in its infancy, this practice we call Christianity now. But even in those days, the church was a mix. Some churches were very comfortable, they were free to practice, and they were pretty lukewarm in their beliefs. There were sufficiently well-off people to finance the church, but other parts of the church were rooted in slave and peasant communities, and some were having a really hard time. That could be a description of the church in the 21st century, just as much as it was in the first century. Lukewarm Christians ministering in situations that are relatively stable, Christians who are up against it economically, but sharing resources with each other and the joy and respite in the church. And then Christians who really do have their back against the wall. They face real persecution in countries like Pakistan and China and so on. There is no doubt that the church has exaggerated the level of persecutions that took place in the Roman era. They were real, but they were periodic, they were occasional. When they happened, the courage of those faced with persecutions really stood out. Those people were held up as the true followers of Jesus. And it's their stories which are told of the early church. Not least because the example of Jesus himself was to give his life rather than to succumb to the temptation of yielding to the powers of temple and empire. So according to John's Gospel, Jesus said to his disciples, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has a greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends." To lay down one's life for one's friends. "You are my friend. Do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to everything that I have heard from my Father." So Jesus is saying, that there is this requirement, this need of people to give as part of their way of following him, even to the point of giving their lives. So, in the vision which the prophet John has from his prison cell on the island of Patmos, the vision which we know of the book as the Book of Revelations, we have the image of a throng of people dressed in white. These are the martyrs. They are the people who have died in persecution. They are the ones who have suffered for their faith. They are the ones who have stood up for justice. And they remain the people who influence and inspire. They are the people we call saints. And they remain. Not all will have been assassinated, but they will all have sacrificed much in order to live the way of Jesus. And they are our inspiration. Let me share you just a personal experience. I think it is the Franciscan approach to Christianity which I find most appealing, makes a lot of sense. And I visited Assisi and went into the chapel where St. Francis is, where his tomb is situated, where he's buried. And I'm not very susceptible to these things, so it was a very strange experience to me. But I really felt the presence and the spirit of St. Francis in that space. A very strange experience for me. It's something I'll never forget. It felt that there was an aura, a presence in that space, which was still part and parse of our experience. This person was still radiating some goodness, which defied his death. We should never forget that well-known saying of Tertullian, the Church Father: "The blood of the martyrs is the seed of Christians." So we will all want, I'm sure, to add to our list of people we admire, those people who in recent years have died for their faith. I would include people like Dorothy Stang, who was assassinated in Brazil in 2005. She believed very passionately in sustainable agriculture. She died at the hands of large landowners protecting God's planet from exploitation. She's often pictured with this t-shirt which says, "The death of the forest is the death of our lives." She also said when she was under threat, "I don't want to flee, nor do I want to abandon the battle of these farmers who live without any protection in the forest. They have the sacrosanct right to aspire to a better life on land where they live and work with dignity while respecting the environment." She was assassinated, I think, at the age of 78. The Book of Revelation gives great hope. These are the people who will be washed in blood, redeemed, forgiven, given a pride of place as history unfolds. I think it was in 1978, the South African Air Force bombed a refugee settlement in Angola, where supporters of SWAPO, now the main party in Namibia, but then opposing the apartheid regime, were living. Over 600 people were killed, 167 of them women, 298 of them children and teenagers. It wasn't, as they said, a military camp, it was a refugee settlement. And Kasinga was in a very remote area, so it was days and days and days before the news came out that the attack had taken place. In one of the anniversaries, I think it was the 20th anniversary of that attack, I organized a service in memory of those people who had died. And the clergy of Westminster Abbey were kind enough to allow us to have the service in the Abbey, in the Henry the VII Chapel, which is at the back. It's a very beautiful place. If you get the chance to go in to that, it's an amazing part of the Westminster Abbey where the monarchs of the British Isles are are buried is at the heart of the imperial power, if you like. And what we'd done in that service was to turn history on its head. In a place where the great and the powerful are honoured and remembered, we remembered the people who were most forgotten and were most outside and most unknown. And for me, that is what Revelation is telling us. These are the people who will hunger no more, thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat, for the Lamb at the centre of the throne will be their shepherd. It's right that the church acknowledges our debt as a church, and our debt as a human species to these brave people. But it can be overwhelming. One older member of the congregation at the church in Bethnal Green, where I was minister, used to talk about the area in the East End a lot when the gangsters were under sway. She used to talk of the gangster Reggie Crane. She would say, he was a saint. He was a saint compared to his brother. And while I don't think we need to think to make such extreme comparisons, it makes me feel like that sometimes. The saints are beyond our reach. They are worthy of our imagination, but beyond our capacity to emulate them and copy them. And I doubt I would have the strength and courage that they show. But I'm not sure either if we need to beat ourselves up if we can't live up to their example. Personally, I draw strength from the Gospel, the passage we call the Beatitude. Comes from the Sermon on the Mount. It's a beautiful poem written in the very familiar style of Hebrew poetry. Blessed are the poor. Who are the poor? And the poem tells us exactly who are the poor. They are the poor in spirit, those who have been beaten down by the daily grind of making ends meet. They are those who mourn. Yes, those who are bereft of a loved one, and those who mourn for their lost land, a lost language, a lost way of life. They are the meek, that is the landless, the homeless. They are those who believe passionately in justice, and those who show love and compassion and kindness. They are those who are diligent in prayer, and those who work for peace in a world racked with war. They are those who are persecuted and reviled, people we've been talking about this morning. What I find reassuring about this poetic description of the people who are blessed is that not everyone in that list need be a hero or a heroine. There are people who are there by virtue of the condition in which they find themselves, and others that are there because they've made a conscious decision to follow the path which Jesus has taught us to follow. We can't all be saints, but we can all blessed, and that is what the kingdom season tells us. We are not isolated human beings who have no place or meaning in the great scheme of God's history. Rather, we belong to a great throng, a great cloud of witnesses. Some will be exceptional and have earned the white robes and pride of place, but the ordinary ones among us may still be blessed. The kingdom of God can still belong to us. The comforting touch of Jesus may still be felt on our shoulder. The earth, polluted and exploited though it be, can still belong to those who love and care for its spectacular intricacy and the interdependent nature of creation. The satisfaction of wrongs being put right will still make it worth our while fighting for justice. And the peacemakers put themselves in dangerous situations will be vindicated over and above the arms dealers. They may appear naive, but they are the children of God. I'm describing to you an interconnected community of the followers of Jesus, all those who share our values and aspirations for the future of humanity and the environment we inhabit. The Bible readings this morning tell us we can sing alongside those who are blessed of God. Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever those people who put themselves in risky situations to defend the rights of others. We pray for those who systematically use the political process and the law, and the practice of law, to protect the rights of others and to ensure that those rights are available for all. We pray for those who are facing a hard time, those who find it difficult to make ends meet, those who are finding it hard to find work or somewhere decent to live. We pray for those who mourn and remember those people have known and loved and miss in our lives, those recently bereaved. We pray for those who are stateless, thinking especially of the Rohingya people in Myanmar at this time. We pray for those who seek to develop the spiritual life of the church, those who seek after new ways of understanding our own spirits and our way of being in the world, finding peace and calmness and giving peace and calmness. We pray for those who care for our environment, the earth in which we live. We pray for those who make peace and work for peace and care for. Pray for the church in persecution, those who continue to give of the love of Jesus despite personal threat and danger. And we pray for ourselves, that we might know the blessed nature of our own humanity. We may know how we fit in to this community of believers which Jesus has initiated in the kingdom of God. This we ask in your name. Amen. So we're going to sing Lord of Light, whose name outshineth. I'm going to play the organ, so give you time to get your collection ready. We'll have the opportunity during this hymn.
Amen.
peoples of this earth, with those with whom we share a common passion for truth and for peace, a common conviction in the kingdom of justice we believe is coming on earth. We give thanks with all who rest in you, for victims of war and violence, with all who have inspired your people, saints, mystics, teachers, martyrs, and defenders of the poor. With them and the whole company of heaven, we claim your great name throughout the earth, the new great name of love. Ever praising you and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. May the pure light of Jesus Christ, the holy light in which we live our lives, consecrate these things. Light of the world. May we be united to Christ through the presence of the Holy Spirit, who died that we might share his name and become one as he and the Father are one. Light of the world. May we become living sacraments through the power of the Holy Spirit, taking Christ's love for our own, seeding others with the bread of God, healing others with the life and the wine. Light of the world. Send down your Spirit upon this prayer and upon your believers gathered. Today and the week of the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the night in which we have prayed, the rest of the torture to the bread, into his holy and innocent hands. With his eyes lifted up towards heaven, he gave thanks to you, Almighty God our Father. He blessed it, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, All of you, take and eat of this. This is my body which is broken. Do this in remembrance of me. Like manna after supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he blessed it and gave it to his disciples, saying, All of you drink of this. For this is my blood of the new and everlasting cup, which is shed for you. God our Father, who saw us in the distance and came to meet us to bring us home. Jesus Christ, who saw us in our need and came to meet us and share us. Holy Spirit, who saw our hunger and came to feed us with spiritual food, may we go out from this place in the power of the three to bring life to others. Blessed Trinity, keep us strong, set all your children free, and let the universe sing your praise. And our closing hymn, you servant and master. Rest and remain with each and every one of us, now and forevermore.